in our own small ways to improve the levels of our taqwa and the levels of our ma'rifah with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. As you know very well, glorious Quran on numerous occasions remind us of the importance of consciousness or taqwa. The verse I've just quoted from glorious Quran is Surah At-Tawbah, verse 91. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in this beautiful ayah highlights circumstances of some group of people when it comes to wudu. And then Allah at the end of the ayah says, once they are in that situation and they don't have water to make wudu, they can make tayammum to make wudu. Now, departing from this ayah of glorious Quran, which I will explain the ayah later more, our theme of this month, the month of Rabi'ul Akhar, is to look at the akhlaaq of Ahlulbayt alayhi wasalam, underpinning the akhlaaq of Ahlulbayt. And the aim of this theme is to equip us with the best practices of akhlaaq from our beloved Imams alayhi wasalam. No doubt, Ahlul Bayt are our role models. Ahlul Bayt are the personalities that we look up to. So therefore, it's important Ahlul Bayt become the yardstick to measure our akhlaq in order to see whether your akhlaq is a good akhlaq or bad akhlaq. And of course, discussing the akhlaq of Ahlul Bayt, Mu'mineen and Mu'minat, is massive, is an ocean. So naturally, within 1 month or 4 weeks of Jum'ah, we will not be able to do due diligence to the entire akhlaq of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wassalam. So what I'm going to do, inshallah, I'm going to focus on certain areas when it comes to akhlaq of our beloved Imams, and to invite brothers and sisters to take lessons from that. I'm going to focus, number one, our akhlaq towards sick people. How do we relate to people who are sick? It's very, very important we understand the way and manner our beloved Imams related to sick people and how they looked after sick people. So that's the first akhlaq we'll look at. Second akhlaq we'll look at your akhlaq with your neighbors. All of us have neighbors, whether Muslims or non-Muslims. How did Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam relate to their neighbors? I know the common hadith we always hear is that when you stand by your house, 40 houses are your neighbors, 40 these are your neighbors. So we'll discuss that, inshallah, next week. The other area I will want to discuss is akhlaq with your co-workers, those people that you work with, people that you often interact every day at your work. Whether you work from home, or you go to office, or you drive a car, whatever. Whatever the case, there are people that you interact with on daily basis or monthly basis. How do we interact with them? What sort of akhlaq Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam instill on us when it comes to dealing with those people? And the last one I'll look at is our akhlaq towards ulama. How do we relate to our great scholars? How do you relate to those who are charged with authorities? It's so important. So today, inshallah, briefly, in this first sermon, we're going to look at our akhlaq towards sick people, people who are sick. Marba, or someone who is married. And kindly, brothers and sisters, I kindly want you to pay attention to this. Take a lesson or two from this and try as much as you can to implement it. Because I realize that sometimes we fall short of excellent and standard akhlaq when it comes to those people within our communities who are not well. We only tend to become really serious about them when they die. Everybody wants to show his love. But when the person is struggling for 1 month, for 2 months, for 3 months, nobody even bothers. Only the families of that person will struggle taking care of that person. This is totally contrary to the akhlaq of Ahlulbayt alayhi wasalam. And so it's important as Muslims, as lovers and followers of Ahlulbayt, to follow the footsteps of Ahlulbayt. See, you know, in the holy month of Ramadan, we have this daily dua that we recite. Allahumma adkhil ala ahli al-kubur sayyid. Allahumma agni kulla faqir. Said Allahumma ishfi kulla faqir. There's a line. Allahumma ishfi kulla bayt. Allah cure every sick. Who is every sick? He is not even talking of only Muslim sick. You're making dua for everyone who is sick. That tells us anyone who is sick has a right over us. And most especially, those who are ill and we know them. Because the dua is in Allahumma isfi kulla marid. Allah cure every sick. Now, if you are making dua every year, even some of us during other months of the year, we make this dua. This dua will only be effective if you practically implement it. What is the practical way of implementing this dua? Is to pay a visit to someone who is ill. Now, when you come to Quran, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala pays very special and unique attention to those who are ill. And Allah does this just to inspire I and you. The first ayah is Surah Al-Baqarah 185. You know the ayah very well. Allah comes with, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيدًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Allah shows special mercy when it comes to fasting to those who are ill. Allah says, مَنْ كَانَ مَرِيدًا, whoever is ill, or he's on safari traveling, they should not bother to fast. They should only pay some other time after the holy month of Ramadan. This is not just only about fasting. It's talking about the special attention Allah gives to someone who is ill. If Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is giving special attention to someone who is ill, what of I and you, when we know someone within our community who for 3 months you've not seen him, for 1 month you've not seen him, and you do not even bother to ask him about that person? That is totally against the akhlaq of Ahlulbayt. We need to show people love when they are alive, not when they are no more there. We want to bring the entire world to them when they have already gone to their life of barzakh. This is our, you know, when the person that everybody is fighting to touch, I'm not saying it's wrong, it's crucial, it's ibadah, we'll one day discuss about that. But we need to show people that we love them when they are alive. Another ayah of Quran, beautiful, the one I quoted earlier on. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, Surah Al-Ma'idah verse 6. He said, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ مَرْضَىٰ أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ أَوْ جَاءَ أَحَدٌ مِّنْكُمْ مِنَ الْغَائِطِ أَوْ لَامَسْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ فَلَمْ تَجِدُوا مَاءً فَتَيَمَّمُوا صَعِيدًا طَيِّبًا. Again, Allah said, if you are ill, or you are traveling, or you go go for nature call to ease yourselves, or you go close to your families and there is no water to make wudu or make ghusl, make tayammum.
It's fake, but it's trying to tell a special attention Allah gives to someone who is ill. But in kuntum marda, you are ill, you're not traveling, but water is difficult for you, it's pain for you. Allah says, make tayammum, simple way, and make wudu. Even when it comes to struggling towards Allah in terms of during the lifetimes of our Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, when it comes to going to fight alongside Ahlul Bayt, it's no more practical today because we don't have that type of thing today. But Allah comes on and said, Laysa ala al-marda, or Laysa ala al-du'afa, wala ala al-marda, wala ala al-ladhina la yajiduna ma yunfiqoon, haraj. Allah comes on Surah At-Tawbah 91. He said, there is no burden on those who are weak, and those who are ill, and those who do not have what to give to the Holy Prophet or A'imma when they do not participate in those struggles. So in other words, this ayah is also telling us Allah pay special attention to sick. Now, listen, mu'minin and mu'minat. What are our duties and responsibilities to sick people? Because we need to really to, you know, people spend a lot of money when somebody dies. But when he's alive, he's struggling. You hardly pay a visit to him. But when he dies, you want to show you love him than any other person. That's wrong. Yes, you'll get a reward for doing it after the person dies. But the person needs you more when he is alive, because now he's gone. Allah will send the angels to him. He will be next to Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. He needed you here. You're not there. You're busy with your work. You're busy with your friends. You're busy with your errands. He is there at Queen Elizabeth for 1 month, for 2 months, for 3 months. Heartland Hospital. Nobody bothers. Only families are taken care of. Yet after the death, we all want to compete who this janaza belonged to. What are our duties and responsibilities towards marba, towards people who are ill, within the religion of Islam and within the school of thought of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam? First and foremost responsibility is iyadatul marid, paying visits to someone who is ill. It is our duty, it is our responsibility as Muslims, as believers, to pay a visit to someone who is ill, either within our family or within our community or wherever I find myself in my neighborhood. So long as I get to know someone is ill, it is my responsibility to pay a visit to that person. Unless, if for whatever reason, we are not allowed to pay that visit. Because sometimes some families will say, no, we don't want anyone to come. Then, no issue about that. Prophet, if he wouldn't see someone for 3 days in his mosque, he would ask his companions, I have not seen Fulan, Fulan, Fulan. Where are they? And if the answer would be, they are ill, Prophet would say, after Salah, let us go and pay visit to that person. This is the sunnah of Prophet and the sunnah of A'immat al-Masumin. And that is why you find beautiful tradition from our beloved first Imam saying, Amarana Rasulullahi Iyadat al Marid. One version said, Bi Iyadat al Marid. Rasulullah ordered us and commanded us to pay visit to someone who is ill. It is the command of Rasulullah. Otherwise, the dua you make in Ramadan is of no point. Allahumma ishfi kulla marid. If you do not visit marid, that dua has no point. Because you are saying kulla marid, meaning every single sick in the world. Hope for that dua to be effective, you have to pay visit to someone who is ill. Sometimes for leadership of our community, you ask them who is ill in the community, they don't even know. They don't know. It's only when the person dies we start passing messages. One other riwayah about that, Imam Jafar Salawatullahi wa salamuhu ala. He said, "Udu mardakum wa saluhum ad-du'a ya'dilu du'a al-mala'ika." Imam Jafar said, visit your sick people, visit them. Go visit them. And when you visit them, ask them for dua. You know, we'll discuss this more next week. Marie doesn't need your dua, really. You need his dua. As per the tradition of Islam. Because it's kafara, that sickness. Whoever is sick is close to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. As we do dua, no problem. Allah cure, fine. But then Imam Jafar said, "Udu marbakum wa saluhum ad-du'a." Visit your sick people and ask them for dua, because their dua is like the dua of malaika. What tradition that says, when you go to visit a sick person, ask him for the dua, for the fulfillment of your hajat. And Allah will fulfill your hajat. Al-Muhim, it is crucial for us to pay visit to those who are ill. It is our responsibility. They feel good when they see us. They feel they are part of this community. They feel they are part of this family. They feel they are not alone in that pain. Because Marid, he knows the pain he is going through. Seeing you is enough for him. And I'm sure all of us, one way or the other, went through certain sickness in our lives. And we know the pain of sickness. One of the things that relieves or lessen the burden of that pain is when you see people coming to visit you. Second responsibility that we have towards a sick person, as per the traditions of Ahlul Bayt, is what? Muraqabatul Marida. Is to look after sick person. Paying visit is something else. Looking after the person is something else. You pay visit for mu'min, mu'mina. Buy some food, fruit. The person doesn't need, take, go give. Meet the family. Do you need anything from me? Let them be overwhelmed by their love. That is the quality of the community the Holy Prophet established. Let the ummah, let the person be overwhelmed by their love. Not when the person died, the house is full. They don't want people even to come. Everybody is going. Muraqabatul marid. Take care of that marid. Look after that marid. And if that marid is, of course, from your family, then it becomes then very crucial on you to ensure that you look after that marid. And we'll discuss about that more next week. The reward of someone who look after a sick person. So many reward in dunya and akhirah. Typical example I give you. We have one tradition. During the lifetime of our beloved first imam, one of his companions, the narration has not mentioned the name, they were traveling. And one of them fell ill. And they decided to approach Amir al-Mu'minin and ask him. Amir al-Mu'minin said, no, stop the journey. Spend 3 days looking after him until he becomes better. So we get from this that it is important to look after someone who is ill. You know, we are busy with our lives. Everybody is busy. There has never been a time when people are not busy. Ever since I grew up, I've never seen a time when somebody come and tell me I'm not busy. So if today, you know, life is too busy. Life has been busy ever since we came to this world. And it will continue to be busy until the world is wrapped up. You have to make time. Because these small, small things will matter in dunya and akhirah. And the same thing. During the lifetime of our beloved Sif Imam, one companion, Muzamir, and Muhammad ibn Musadif, they were traveling. Then Muhammad Musadif became ill. They came back. So when they came back, Muzamir will always go to see him, and then he'll go to the mosque and pray. So he decided to go to Imam Jafar and ask him to make dua for him, and he told Imam what happened. Imam looked at him and said, "Qu'uduka 'indahu afdal min salatika fil masjid." Imam Jafar looked at Muzamir. He said, "No, you sitting next to him is better than going to the mosque and pray." Marid. Allahumma ishfi kulla marid. We make dua. Allahu Akbar. Said, you go sit next to him. It's better than you going to the mosque and pray. Because he needs you now. Maybe you sitting next to him, reciting some verses of glorious Quran, reminding the person of Ahlulbayt al-Isma wa Tahara, will make the person to exit from this world successfully. So that is really very, very important. And based on this, there is a very beautiful tradition, again, from our beloved Sheikh Imam. On the right of a believer over another believer. Imam said there are seven rights. We're not going to look at the seven rights all here. The first and foremost of the right is that, is to love for a mu'min brother what you love for yourself, and to dislike for a mu'min brother what you dislike. Today, how many of us want to put others in pain and we don't care? He is in pain, but you are carrying on with what you want. It's the right of a believer not to put or subject believer to pain. One of the rights of a believer over another believer is to pay visit to a believer when believer is ill. You know what Imam Jafar said? وَمَنْ خَالَفَ ذَلِكَ. Whoever goes against that, not giving believer his or her right, خَرَجَ مِنْ وِلَايَةِ اللَّهِ وَتَرَكَ طَاعَةَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. The person now will be out of the wilaya, the guardianship of Allah. And the person will be regarded as someone who has ignored being obedient to Allah. You know, it's not only tahajjud, only coming mosque every day. Simple akhlaq can take you to the next level in the eye of Allah. Especially in this day and age, where life is cumbersome, it's very complicated. People are going through headaches. People are ill. People are suffering. There are people 1 year, they've not even gone to their mosques because they are ill indoor. Only the families, the wife or the husband or the children are suffering. It is our duty that we find out about them and we go pay them visits. You are not doing any favor to whomsoever you pay visit to. You are playing your part, and it is their God-given right as per the dictate of Quran and Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. Not to drag this much. You know what riwayah mentioned? Saying even if they are not Muslims, even if they are not Shias, it doesn't matter. You know them. They are your colleagues, they are your friends, they are your neighbors. Pay visit to them. You know what the narration said? Khalifuhum bi akhlaqikum. It's a narration from Imam Jafar. When our enemies during that time, their animals would do something contrary over Ahlul Bayt. So Ahlul Bayt said, you do different akhlaq from the akhlaq. But what interests me so? Sallu fi masajidihim wa udu mardahum wa shhadu janaizahum. فَإِنِ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ أَن تَكُونُوا الْمُؤَذِّنِينَ أَوْ الْأَئِمَّةِ فَفَعَلُوا. Imam Jafar said, pray in their mosques when they need be. Go Sunni mosque if they need be, pray. And Imam said, عُودُوا مَرْضَاهُمْ. Visit their sick. If Imam is telling you, visit their sick, what of your own sick? Because when you are ill, you will wish them to come and visit you. But you don't want to go and visit them because you are too busy with your work. Life is so complicated that we carrying it and chasing behind life. And Imam said, washhadu janaizahum ba'd. And also, go to the janaza. But at the end of that, why, you know what Imam said? Haza ma kana ahsan, haza kana ahsan ma yu'addibu Ja'far ashaba. This is the best way that Jafar used to discipline his servant with, his companions with. Visit them, visit them, visit them. You know, they came to Medina from safari, and there was someone who was ill. Nobody would want to sit next to that person. Prophet stood up and he went and sat next to the person. Companions always said, but this is, of course, sitting next to me, are like sitting next to Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Because on the day of Qiyamah, Allah will ask, there will be a question, when I was ill, this you hear it from the Sunnis, we also have it in our book, by the way. When I was ill, you did not visit me. When I needed help, you did not help me. So the servant will say, Ya Allah, when have you been ill that time? He said, when my servant Fulan was ill, you did not pay visit. If you had gone there, you would have found me there. So that is crucial, mu'minin and mu'minat. So therefore, we need to change our mindset when it comes to the way we treat sick people. Sometimes we've got elderly people who are ill, they come to the mosque. Some don't respect them. They get undermined. It's totally against akhlaaq of Ahlulbayt. You see, a young fellow, elderly person coming, doesn't have a space to sit, he doesn't want to give him a space. You know, akhlaaq of Ahlulbayt is what? You won't eat food if you are sitting next to an elderly before you start eating. Akhlaaq of Ahlulbayt, you will not sit until an elderly person sits. That's the akhlaaq of Ahlulbayt alayhi wasalam. You're sitting on the same dining, you'll not put your hand until that elderly person put his hand. Because they are du'afa also, they are weak also, some of them. So it's important. And if you really want to understand how important it is to pay visit to a sick person, ask those people who nursed sick people until they died. Ask some husbands, ask some wives, ask some children. No sleeping every night. So it is important. And last but not least, you know, tradition makes it very clear. Whoever visits a sick person, Allah will grant him alf hasana, 1,000 good. And Allah will wipe off alf sayya, 1,000 bad deeds. And your status would be elevated 1,000 times levels. This, the reward of someone who visits a sick person. And the last one said, وَيَقْعُدُونَ الْمَلَائِكَ عَلَىٰ كَبْرِهِ وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لَهُ بَعْدَ مَمَاتِهِ. Angels will come and sit next to your grave and ask for forgiveness of Allah on your behalf. So therefore, mu'minin and mu'minat, inshallah, we'll continue with this khutbah next week. Let's really remember the plight of those who are not well. And take a cab, take a bus, go visit them. They appreciate that more than when you do after their death. It's like a person struggling with money. You don't give, but when he die, you want to contribute towards his janazah, majlis for the janazah. What's the point? I need the money now. No, niyaz for that janazah. Hope so what? He need it now. I'm not saying after death is not important, but it's more important when you give to that person. Put the happiness in him. من نفس عن مؤمن كربة من كرب الدنيا نفس الله عنه كربة من كرب يوم القيامة ومن يسر على مؤسر يسره الله في الدنيا والآخرة والله في عون العبد ما دام العبد في عون أخيه. This you've got hadith, sunnatan wa shi'atan, this hadith. Whoever relieve the suffering of a believer, Allah will relieve his suffering on the day of Qiyamah. And whoever make it easy for someone who is in difficulties, Allah will make it easy for you on the day of Qiyamah. So that Allah will continue to assist you so long as you continue to assist your brother and your sister. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, all those who are ill, to cure them with his cure, inshallah. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal that brothers and sisters who are not well, and there is a request for some of our brothers, our father, old man Kanani, who is not well, Ajugulam Ali Kanani, and some of our mu'mineen like Haj Shakir and them. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to cure them with his cure, inshallah. May Allah Azza wa Jal makes it easy for them, inshallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بفضل بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين إنه خير ناصر ومعين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد طب القلوب ودوائها ونور أبصارها وعلى أهل بيته الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا بهم نتولى ومن أعدائهم نتبرى اللهم صل وسلم على علي أمير المؤمنين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى سبتي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى علي بن الحسين زين العابدين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والحجة بن الحسن القائم المنتظر عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وسهل الله مخرجا اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء وألسنتنا من الكذب وأعيننا من الخيانة فإنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور صلوات In our second sermon, very briefly, I first admonish myself and each and every one of you, mu'mineen and mu'minat, brothers and sisters, lovers and followers of Ahlulbayt, to be conscious of the teachings of Almighty Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And let us try as much as we can to improve the levels of our taqwa and to strive in our own small way to follow the footsteps of Ahlulbayt, alayhim alafu tahiyyati wa thana. The first thing that I want to really touch on, which I'm sure if not all of us, some of us came across it, is a report of a BBC on a man who went around attacking Sunni mosques in Periba. And the man, of course, was sentenced yesterday or day before yesterday, I'm not sure. But the report came to light to us yesterday. This man, originally, of course, from Iran, but I'm sure he's been living here for quite some time. The judge who sentenced him, as per what we read from the report, said the man is alcoholic and he also has some mental health related issue. And on the eve of the Iranian National Day celebration, he went around attacking Sunni mosques. Alhamdulillah, nobody got killed in the process. But the BBC, the way it reported it, the BBC said it's a Shia person attacking the Sunni mosques. So we really take exception from this, that this way of reporting can cause problem. This way of reporting can bring about friction. And this way of reporting can cause some sort of sectarian fights. You are in Birmingham, brothers and sisters, for quite a long time, and you know this is a great city with its diversity and people of different backgrounds, different walks of life, different faiths have been living together in harmony, peacefully coexisting for quite a long time. We are here at KSIMC or Husseinia or any of our mosques. We enjoy these friendly relationships with our Sunni brothers, not even with only Sunni brothers, with our Christian brothers and the rest. So we found this report to be a concern, because it is totally against the teachings of Ahlulbayt and the teachings of our great scholars Maraja' Azam to even think ill of someone, let alone going there to attack. So this fellow, I don't know, Zadi something his name, he did not represent any Shia. He is a mental health person, he's alcoholic, because if he's a good Muslim and a good Shia, he wouldn't even go to drink alcohol to begin with and become drunk, let alone going to attack. Alhamdulillah, the leadership of our communities demonstrated leadership. When I talk of leadership of our community, I'm talking of the leadership of our main Shia centers in this city. So talking of Husseinia, through the leadership of Brother Dilshad, and of course the leadership of KSIMC of Birmingham, Brother Ghulam, Dilshad managed to contact the head of the police and to speak to him about it. And he assured him that this will not cause any friction between the Sunni and Shia. And if there is anything untoward too, we should not hesitate to report to them. And which I know, inshallah, very well, our Sunni brothers and sisters that I know in this city, they will not go ahead to do something untoward. They are very good people. I'm not saying this for saying sake. We have excellent relationship with them without a shadow of doubt. We visit their houses, they invite us, we invite them, we sit together, we eat together. So thank you so much, Dilshad and Husseinia, for taking the lead. And also, Brother Ghulam, our leader from KSIMC last night, he also reported to BBC. And this morning, BBC responded to him that we will respond into details within a short space of time. And some members of our community also reported to BBC, they complained. What we need to do, brothers and sisters, our responsibility and role as lovers and followers of Ahlulbayt, if somebody, of course, meet us and ask us, said, no, this person did not represent Shia, he's not a Shia, we don't believe in him, he is coward, it's nothing to do with us. But definitely our solidarity and empathy and sympathy with the mosques that are affected. They are our brothers. In fact, Aga Sistani said, Sunnis are not just our brothers, they are ourselves. Said Sistani, said, they are ourselves. We are one single ummah. So therefore, inshallah, let's all relax. Nothing to panic about. This will flow. And then inshallah, we'll wait for the response of BBC. Our request from them is either for the report to be removed completely, or the report has to be altered and to be edited. That Shia attacking Sunni, that is a worrying factor there. Somebody ignorant can pick it out somewhere and then start thinking it's not like. This is currently what has happened. We ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to continue to make us live in peace and harmony, inshallah. Whatever is going to cause fitna and problem, may Allah eliminate it, inshallah. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala continue to inspire us with the true teachings of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to forgive us our shortcomings. Our marhumin, may Allah forgive them and grant them Jannat al-Firdaus. On the 12th of December, the country will be going to elect the new leadership. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make it easy and let it go smoothly without any problem and altercation, inshaAllah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Allahu samadu lam yalid wa lam yulad. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.